Hey, welcome back. This is video number 11 in this Helm mini course on YouTube. This is part of a much bigger Kubernetes course. It's 30 hours long and available at udemy.com and Virtual Pair Programmers. There's a link in the description below, and you'll also find a link there to my Istio course. In the previous video, we saw most Kubernetes projects would benefit from writing their own Helm charts. And in this video, we'll see how to do exactly that by writing a Go template. Let's get started. In the previous video, then, we saw that Helm, although it was originally designed as a package manager, which would enable projects that need to package up their Kubernetes YAML and broadcast it, if you like, to a large number of users, a large number of different consumers. That was the original intention of Helm. But it turns out that the features of Helm, in particular, its template processing, proves very useful to projects who don't need to package up and broadcast their software. So we're working on an example here, and I have heavily simplified this. We have some standard YAML that any regular project might use. And although this YAML is purely intended for our own servers, we're not needing to publish this. We're certainly not going to be putting this onto the artifact hub, it turns out that we are going to get a very big benefit from converting this YAML into a Helm chart. And that benefit is all of this YAML can become dynamic. And by dynamic, I simply mean we can configure it using variables. As a motivating example, we're focusing on line 19 here, where I would like to set up some kind of a system where we can say, where we can make this chart be deployable either as a production system or as a development system. And I don't want to have to maintain two separate versions of this YAML file. So the plan then is we're going to convert this YAML into a Helm chart. Well, although on this course so far we haven't looked at how to build a Helm chart, we have had a few sort of sneak peeks at the inner workings of a Helm chart. I'm in the folder that I set up previously where I downloaded an offline local copy of the Kube Prometheus stack. And I'm just using this one as an example. If we have a look at the contents in here, you'll soon start to recognize that this is the standard format of any Helm chart. There's some crucial elements in here that really that any Helm chart has to have. We have a chart.yaml file. We have a charts folder. We have a README, we have a templates folder, and we have values.yaml. There's also a few other little bits and pieces that aren't so important. To build our own chart, we're going to have to replicate this structure. And in particular, really the starting point is you do need, it's a required file, you do need to have this chart.yaml file. So that might look a little bit daunting at first. Actually, none of this structure is particularly difficult to set up from scratch. So you need to be in a folder. It doesn't particularly matter where you are on your file system, but I'm going to reuse that my cluster config folder that I set up previously. So you'll remember that in here I have Kube Prometheus stack and MySQL. But really, it can be anywhere. Just work somewhere clean. And to start a brand new chart, we can use the command helm create, followed by the name of the chart that you want to create. This will be your project name. So for us, I'm going to go for Fleetman. I think to be clear, I'm going to call it Fleetman-Helm-Chart. And that's it, no fuss. So do a directory listing, and it has created a folder. And if we go into that folder and list its contents, you can see that we do have the bare bones structure. Not everything that we saw in that previous professional chart is there, but the main elements are the chart.yaml file, and then two directories, charts and templates, and values.yaml. So what's in there? Well, I suggest we open this up in a proper text editor. So let's have an explore of the structure of these files. Let's have a look at these two folders first of all. We have a folder called charts, which is currently empty, and we have a folder called templates, which actually has a lot of stuff inside it. Now, that's scaring me a little bit. So let's come back to that in a moment. The starting point really is this file called chart.yaml. This file is the metadata for this chart. In other words, it's just useful information about this chart that an end user of the chart will find useful. If you're making a Helm chart to distribute to thousands of users, if you're going to be publishing something on the Artifacts Hub, for example, maybe you're a big open source project or similar, then this file is critical because this forms part of the user guide for your chart. And you definitely want to be putting some care and attention into this file. If this chart is for your own private purposes on your project, which I think in my head at least is what most people watching this video will be interested in, this file isn't particularly useful. Let's just skim down it. We have a name for the chart. We have a description for the chart. And there's a default value in here, which is very vanilla. We probably should override this. So this is going to be the Helm chart for the entire Fleetman project. And this would depend on your project. Maybe this chart is just for a single microservice. Whatever, this description is just intended for somebody who doesn't know what this chart is all about. The next field is the type of chart, and there's two options here. Either it can be an application chart or a library chart. Now, this is something that we definitely won't be using on this course. As I said, you can get pretty advanced with Helm, and a library chart would be something more advanced. The comment confirms that a library chart is where you want to set up a library of functions that you want to share across multiple charts. That's definitely outside of the scope of this course. Application is definitely what we want here. And then all that remains are two versions. And the first version is intended to be the version of the chart, whereas the second version, the app version, is the version number of the application itself. Now, again, really, I think this first version is principally of use, again, if you're publishing to a wide community, if you're broadcasting this chart, of course you need to apply some configuration management to it. Helm are quite strict here, and they're saying that you should follow proper semantic versioning, which means this is the major version, this is the minor version, and this is the patch version, if you're releasing bug fixes, for example. Really, if this is an internal chart that you're publishing internally, nobody's going to care what version numbers you use here. Maybe you would adopt a project principle that the version here just matches the version of the application. It doesn't really matter. So hope that makes sense. This first version is intended for end users of the chart. This version is your internal application number. On this project, let's just say we're in the early stages and we're going to say the application is still at version 0.1.0. You don't need semantic versioning here, so this is just going to follow whatever standard your project uses. So maybe we have a 0.1.0 beta, say. So nothing to get excited about in this chart.yaml file, but it is a required file. I think it's time now to look at what is interesting in the Helm chart, and that's this folder here called templates. What's going to happen is that any YAML file inside this template folder is going to be sent through a text processor, which is going to ultimately generate the Kubernetes YAML that we need. Now, I'm being vague for now about what that text processor is. We will come onto that very shortly. The important thing for now is that every YAML file, I should say, that it finds inside this folder will be sent through that text processor. Now, if we look in the contents of this folder, Helm has automatically, for free, given us a set of pre-written YAML files. Now, these are really examples or demonstrations of what you can do with this text processing system. And these are pretty useful as examples as to what you can do. But I think right now they are a little bit overwhelming and a bit confusing until you've understood the basics. So whilst I would find these useful if I was working on a project and I'd just been given a really complex thing to do, maybe I could do a web search to get an answer, or maybe I could look for inspiration in one of these files. As I say, though, for now, I think it's a little bit overwhelming. So I'm going to suggest that actually we just take the entire contents of that folder. So it's all these YAML files. There's also notes.txt and helpers.tpl. There's also a subfolder called tests in there. I'm just going to delete all of those files. Of course, it doesn't matter how you do that. So now we have an empty templates folder. What I said before is that when we run any of the Helm processes, such as Helm install or Helm upgrade, it's going to look inside this templates folder. It'll pick up any YAML file it finds. Those YAML files will be processed and will become part of the output. So I'd like to test that by just creating a new file inside this templates folder. And we're going to throw this file away in a few moments. You can call it anything you like. So I don't know, I'm going to go for 1.yaml. I'm going to put in here any random YAML. Yeah, I'm quite uninspired today. I think I'm just going to go for hello world, and I'm going to set world to true. That will, yes, not very exciting, but it will do for a quick demo. But believe it or not, what we have now, because we have the chart.yaml file, and we've got something, albeit not very exciting, but something in the templates folder, we now have a valid Helm chart. Actually, there is the values.yaml file, which I've not mentioned. Once again, that contains a lot of, it's just example values. They're there as a starting point. They're not necessary. They are actually used by those sample templates that we've deleted. So we can clear out. I've just deleted all of the contents of the values.yaml file. I'm going to leave the file in place because we both know by now that that file is definitely going to be needed. So we're going to leave it empty. And what I'm trying to say here is that we really don't have much in here at all now. The charts folder, I will explain what that is a little later on, but it's currently empty. We've got a single YAML file in templates. We've got that chart.yaml file, which we know now is pretty dull, but that's it. But now, if we switch to the command line, so remember, we're working in this folder called Fleetman Helm Chart. I'll change directories into there. And now we can do any of the Helm processes that we've been doing previously in the earlier videos. If we try to do a Helm install or a Helm upgrade, it's going to process all of these YAML files, and the resulting output will be sent to kubectl apply. Well, look, this isn't anything like valid Kubernetes syntax. So although it will try to apply it to our cluster, the applying will fail. But the key point is it will do the processing. So Helm install and Helm upgrade isn't going to work yet. But what will work is if we run Helm template. Now, you'll remember just previously, a couple of videos ago, we used Helm template to spit the resulting YAML onto the console. And we can do exactly that right now. And we don't need any other parameters apart from a dot to say that we're using as the input, we're using the contents of this directory. Before I do that, I should just do an ls to remind you that we are in the root directory of the chart. So Helm template dot is going to run the processor. And can you see that we have some output, which is pretty much, it's really just echoing the sample YAML that we put in the file. It's added a little bit extra. It has put a document separator there. And this is really to help future debugging. It's giving us a link to the source of where that data came from. And that was our 1.yaml file. So it hasn't done anything clever, but you can possibly see now, we can add in now as many files as we like into this templates folder. Let's try it. We'll add a new file called 2.yaml. And I'm going to have to invent some YAML now. I'm not very good at writing YAML. If you're following along, it really doesn't matter what you put in here as long as it's YAML. Now, if I go back and run the processing again, fantastic. You can see now that it's taking the entire contents of that directory and combining together into a single output. And before we do something proper here, it is important to remember that this does need to be valid YAML. If I deliberately break the YAML, I think that is invalid YAML. If I try running the Helm template again, yeah, we do indeed get a YAML parse error on that particular file, and it's telling me which line is the offending line. I don't think we'll use this file any further, but I might as well to correct that problem. So that's the first thing to learn about how the Helm charts work. All of the files in the templates folder that are YAML files are going to be crunched together into a single big output. It's important to note that barring a few exceptions, the contents of the templates folder does need to be YAML files. I can verify this by, if I put in a new file here called test.txt, for example, and just put some random text in there, then running the template process again, yeah, I'm getting a YAML error on that file, even though it's clearly not a YAML file. So for the most part, this processing, whatever processing is going on here, is expecting YAML files. There is a little exception to that, but I will come back to that shortly. Let's concentrate on what's important, and that's we can combine multiple YAML files together and it's going to generate a single output. So that's quite interesting, I suppose. But what's the point of this? All we're doing at the minute is taking multiple files and combining them into a big one. But I think it's now time to really get to the heart of the matter, which is that the YAML files that we're seeing here aren't just YAML files. In fact, they are input files into a text processor. And the text processor is from the Go language or Golang. Now, I have no idea if you're familiar with Golang, and I'm really definitely not an expert in Golang. It just so happens that the developers of Helm have decided to use this language to implement their charts. If you're really interested, you can obviously look in detail on the web at the user guide for the Go templating language on the homepage of their documentation here, but actually their examples are not related to the YAML that we're working on and not related to Helm. But I just wanted to show you this really, to show you where all of this comes from. If you're already an expert in Go templating, then the rest of what's to come is going to be very easy for you. But I'm guessing most of you won't be familiar with it. So there is a what they call here a trivial example, which is clearly some Go code. But can you see that there are some blocks in the middle of here which are wrapped in double curly brackets? Now, these are expressions in the templating language. Don't worry, you don't have to learn Go in order to implement some pretty useful Helm charts. What we can do in any of these YAML files is we can use that double curly bracket syntax ourselves right here. And when the Helm processing happens, whatever's inside the curly brackets will be evaluated. Let's try it out here in our 1.yaml file where at the moment I've hard-coded in the string true. Instead of doing that, I could use the double curly brackets and in here I could plug in some Go code. Now, as I say, I am no expert in Go, but I know there is a function in Go called printf, which allows me to do formatted printing. So I could, for example, just output the string true. So not very useful yet, but I want to illustrate that this code is going to be executed when we run the Helm template process. And whatever the results of this are, we'll substitute the double curly brackets block. Let's try that. Making sure we're in that chart directory then, it'll be Helm template followed by a dot. And yes, that's working, as you can see with the highlight there. Just to check that wasn't a fluke and we've somehow picked up the old version, let's switch this to false and run again. And yeah, so we can see that it definitely is executing that code. So in this case, the Go that we've provided here isn't useful. I could have, of course, just hard-coded string in. But this can now, of course, be any valid Go. So we can write any dynamic code in here that we like. Now, I really don't want you to be worrying that you have to go away and learn a lot of Go. You really don't. But you'll find you can write some serious Helm charts with really very little knowledge of Go. And I'm going to illustrate that, I think, by switching now to the proper example. We want to be able to make our Fleetman YAML file be dynamic. We want it to be useful in production and development. So I think we can get rid now of our 1 and 2 YAML files. And we're back now to an empty templates folder. By the way, it is valid now to run the Helm template process. We will just get no output. That's absolutely fine. And what I want to do is get the Fleetman Helm demo start.yaml file that you got hold of at the start of this section and transfer that into the templates folder. I'm going to do that by creating a new file. It really doesn't matter what we call it. I'll go for fleetmanfull.yaml. As I say, if you prefer, you can just transfer the original file into here. So, of course, we have no Go in here, but that doesn't matter. As you know now, if we run Helm template, it will run it through the processor, which is not going to do anything in this case, and then output the results. Even though we've started with one single file in this case, when the processor detects a document separator, the three dashes, it will go and put the source reference in as well. Just to be clear, this line and this line were definitely not present in the original YAML. So there's no Go in here. We haven't got any of those curly brackets. So it just went through almost unaltered apart from those comments being added. But of course, now we can start using these Go actions. Now, the aim is going to be to use one image if we're in development mode and a different image if we're in production mode. I'll come on to that in a moment. That might be a little bit complicated, but I'll start with something a bit simpler. Let's say that we want to be able to configure the number of replicas that we use for this web app deployment. I'm sure by now you're familiar with the concept of a deployment, and we can have multiple replicas of a pod. We don't want that hard-coded in anymore. We want to be able to configure that. Well, it's time now finally to show where the values.yaml file comes in. We can make up in here any key value pairs that we like. For example, we could have a property called, I'm going to make it sort of long-winded, so it's obvious that it's something that we've invented. We could have in here something like number of web app replicas. And we could set that to any value we like. Let's go for a random number of 4. So that's in values.yaml. And now back in the template file, we can reference that value really easily. Instead of hard coding in the one, we can drop in here one of those Go, they're called actions. And for this Go action, we don't need any fancy Go code because it's already being done for us, really. We can immediately reference the contents of the values.yaml file by using dot values. Notice there's a capital V there. And then after that, and following another dot, we can now reference any property in that YAML structure. Of course, I used a stupidly long property name there. I'll copy that. I can now reference that from the template, which is fantastic. Of course, YAML is hierarchical, and as you've seen from previously, the values.yaml file is as well. So we might decide that we want all of these values to be part of maybe a parent key called webapp, and therefore we would need to indent this with spaces. So you know this already from our earlier work, but we would therefore need to include this in the structure here. We will be putting in webapp dot. So that's how you reference, well, I'm saying here, this is how you reference the values.yaml file, but it's more than that. If this value were overridden by using dash dash set on the command line, then it would be picked up here. And also if you override it with a custom values.yaml file. I'll demonstrate that in a few moments, but I'd like to see first if this works. So again, we are in the root directory of that chart, and we just need to run helm template dot again. Let's have a look at what we've got here, and let's highlight the key line that we are indeed picking up that 4 from the values file. But just to be clear, it's more than just the values file. If on the command line, we were to override that using dash dash set, and then it would be webapp dot, I'm really regretting this now, number of webapp replicas. Let's paste that in. Let's set it to something ridiculous like 127. And very importantly, you can see that that is being picked up. I hope you expected that. Based on the previous work we've done in earlier videos with dash dash set. But it's good to know, I think, that we really don't need to do anything clever to get hold of that value. And that's what I mean by you really don't need very much Go at all in order to get pretty useful in writing your own charts.